And it's my pleasant task this afternoon to be the moderator for this Pacific session on promoting sustainable development in the Pacific Islands through trade. Some of our ministers and the Honourable Andrew Robb, the Minister of, for Trade of Australia, is also will be arriving at 5. So when the ministers arrive, they will take their place in making their statements. But we will now proceed with the Honourable Minister from the Kingdom of Tonga, who has already arrived. And also to fill in the time, we thought we would invite Dr. Edwin Ikesi, who is known to our region, and to compliment you on some of the trade integration issues that are taking place in the Pacific region. So with that brief introduction, the theme for this session this afternoon is promoting sustainable development in the Pacific Islands through trade. The Pacific ministers were going to make presentations on different aspects of how they see trade contributing to sustainable development. And also, there will be two speakers on the relevance or the value of aid for trade, and in particular the enhanced integrated program. But depending on how we go with time, we will give priority to the ministers to make statements. So I am honored this afternoon to invite the Honorable Pohiva Tionetoa, the Minister for Commerce and Labor of the Kingdom of Tonga, who will now make his statement.
Thank you. Thank you. Honorable Ministers, Excellencies, Head of Delegations, distinguished colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. It is a great pleasure to be here in Nairobi, and a privilege to addressing you at this site event. Thank you to the International Center for Trade and Sustainable Development for inviting me to be part of this panel's discussion and to speak on the topic of renewable energy and sustainable development. Ladies and gentlemen, the leaders of Pacific small island developing states have been focusing on improved the energy security over the past 4 years. Roadmaps are now in place to guide the development of the energy sector to avoid the drastic effects of changes in fuel prices and helping reduce the effects of climate change are very important issues that are addressed in all of our national development strategic frameworks. The recent agreed Paris Declaration also reinforces the importance of investing in renewable energy to help tackle the climate change. Pacific Island countries depend on imports to meet most of their energy needs, including electricity generation. Our economic development and growth are highly reliant on fossil fuel energy sources. A total of 1.3 billion liters of fuel is imported into the Pacific region per year. We are very vulnerable to the interruptions in supply and to rising fuel costs. The fuel price spikes in the past decade made clear the vulnerability of our region. As a result, we increase emphasis on every efficiency and the use of locally available renewable energy resources. The seed, it is a transformation and transition into a more environmentally friendly society. This will not happen overnight, of course, and you will need a lot of effort and resources. My government, for example, has introduced policies that we believe will help transform not only the economic landscape, but also our fragile physical environment and ecosystems. Our main policy objective is that by 2020, Tonga will have a 50% of its electricity supply generated from renewable resources. Our strategy and plan aims to reduce Tonga's vulnerability to oil price shocks. We also want to improve access to modern energy services in an economically and environmentally sustainable manner. The actions the government is taking to meet this target is collectively called the Tonga Energy Roadmap, or in brief, TEM. This is our policy instrument that guides us as to the most effective way that government intervenes and does not accept the business as usual mode of operation. This TEM is a partnership between government and our development partners who get to certainly develop projects from design through to the final implementations. Energy is not just another problem the government has to grapple with. If we do not fix it, it will be a critical barrier in our quest for poverty alleviation and sustainable development. I am also grateful for the multilateral and bilateral development partners who played a very important role in this process by financing clean technologies in Tonga. They must be acknowledged. These include the World Bank, the Asian Development Bank, the European Union, Japan, China, New Zealand, Australia, and the United Emirates. And forgive me if I have forgotten many names. However, the country is looking to, the country in 2010 had an 80% electrification rate. Now, this has improved to 89%. In 2010, we had a 0.2% renewable energy mix in electricity transformation. That is now 10%. The national grid has achieved major efficiencies in transmission and distribution networks. Tonga has been able to save up to 1 million liters of imported fossil fuel every year. My government is considering parallel intervention in the energy market. This includes improvement in the petroleum supply chains and increased reliance on renewable energy sources. Ladies and gentlemen, we feel that we can't tolerate the rise in energy prices, but we only have a limited space to make the reforms that we need to do. Energy developers, as usual, come to development partners' door with exciting ideas, but deals fall apart when the required financial assistance is not secured or available only on a piecemeal basis. We understand we could do more to achieve our renewable energy goals despite the scarcity of natural resources. We'd have access to technologies that will allow us to reduce emissions substantially, but still, these are not sufficient to solve all the problems. At the same time, an uptake of clean technologies in the developed and developing world must also increase and take place in parallel to help mitigate the effects of climate change on our environment. We hope the Paris Declaration will help contribute to this and lead to significant action. In Tonga, the government under the dam has made progress by putting in place appropriate legislation and administrative reforms. This has helped us improve policy coherence and streamline operations. This is important as we begin to engage the private sector and other stakeholders. I'm aware that energy is just a component of wider concerns about the environment and the effects of climate change. The Tonga Energy Roadmap links energy, climate change, and environment in a direct way. We give these concerns the highest consideration they deserve by elevating them to department levels at the domestic level. At the international level, we have also signed the key relevant conventions. As you are aware, our Pacific Islands are scattered across the largest ocean in the world, and our oceans are often portrayed as being unpredictable, powerful, and as an obstacle to be become to address our isolation, geographical dispersion, and large distance between communities and countries. But us Tongans believe that the ocean is what connects us together. The ocean is what we all have in common. It is what brings us together and connects humanity. Energy is just like our oceans. It will connect trade and economic growth, social development, and environmental protection. Thank you. Maloa pito.
Thank you very much, Honorable Minister. And may I now invite the Honorable Minister Andrew Robb to the podium, and also Minister Faisal Khoya to the top table. So as we proceed, Excellencies, regional colleagues and honorable ministers, and friends of the Pacific, we now are joined by the Honorable Andrew Robb, the Minister for Trade and Investment of Australia, and also the Honorable Faisal Khoya, the Minister for Commerce, Trade and Industry of Fiji. As you would have noted from the program, the Honorable Andrew Robb was supposed to address this side event to open this session. So I would now invite the Minister to make his presentation. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, and could I acknowledge various ministers and trade envoys and the delegates from the Pacific Island countries here this afternoon, and thank you for the opportunity to participate. Before I do, could I just congratulate Tonga on both the priority and the progress that you've made on the energy front. And of course, I think we're all well aware that no country yet, I think, has been able to reach its potential in any sense without regular supplies of power. And so the priority you're attaching to that is, I think, a very important one. And, of course, you need other things to progress, but without electricity, it doesn't happen. So, you know, we really wish you all the best in completing that task. The other important area, of course, which is that's going to be that is very important to, I think, the Pacific Islands, is the issue of trade. In fact, I do feel that it's probably even more important for growth and development than for many other countries. And I do, firstly, though, commend the Pacific Islands Forum Secretariat and the International Centre for Trade and Sustainable Development for organising this session and the broader Trade and Development Symposium that's also that's been organised. I do think that Pacific Island countries' capacity to trade faces some real challenges, which in many other countries, you mentioned the distance, small domestic markets, and of course the narrow basis of production. And they are common issues, common challenges, and they probably make engagement with international markets all the more difficult at the same time. And indeed, I think Pacific Island countries rely on trade and investment for income and consumption more than most countries because of those characteristics. So efforts to improve the global trade system, which we're all here this week to try and do, and improve your ability to engage with it, in particular, I think can't be overstated. It is fundamental to the further growth and prosperity for all the peoples of the Pacific Islands. I think speakers before me, as I understand, have already outlined a range of challenges facing the Pacific and the role that new technologies and new ways of doing business can play in meeting some of those challenges. And I just reflect on what we're witnessing in terms of trade with China. For instance, what Australia is, and it's relevant to all of you. We're now finding with the e-commerce, with the email and the ordering and the role of e-commerce, you've got companies that you would have heard of, Alibaba and JD.com. They've got a customer base of 300 million people in the middle class in China. They've got access to people with platinum cards in their at their banks. They've got tens of millions of people who are able to pay a very premium price for quality product. And they can target it very accurately. And they deliver it directly to their home. They actually create the secure boxes at the bottom of apartment buildings. And they go and source. They're sourcing product. In Australia's case, they're getting agents who are directly signing contracts with farmers for the quality products. And they're being air freighted and they're being shipped, depending on the product. Now, all of those opportunities, I think, it can really accelerate the small and medium businesses' access to international markets, because we're finding that there's no big middle person that they have to go through. They're negotiating directly with a local aggregator of product, and that's it. Then it goes directly to China, and then it's literally within hours in people's homes. I just make that point because there's a lot of other ways in which the technology is improving trade, but this is a quantum leap in terms of small and medium business. A lot of our small and medium, especially our small businesses in Australia, have never had the capacity to control their own marketing in this sense, and it's all happening, and it's happening at such a speed that it's breathtaking in many respects, these developments. So I think a lot of those opportunities are going to come in, and you've got specialist products, you've got premium products, which you'll find a particular market, and you can command a premium price as well. And I think those opportunities are presented by so much of the, especially the e-commerce that's emerging, but other things which are bringing us and our small businesses, all of us for that matter, much closer to the big markets. I will focus my remarks, I think, on just briefly too, I hope, not too long, 6 or 7 minutes to just highlight what we are doing. And you can make your own assessment then of whether some of these things are what you think are the best or not. We're trying to, in terms of our relationship with the Pacific Islands, which we think is our most important relationship, that we are working hard. And a lot of it is really coming under the auspice of our Aid for Trade program. We've made a very conscious decision to drive a lot of our support into the region through the Aid for Trade program. We've been a strong supporter of the WTO and the OECD Aid for Trade initiatives since their beginning in 2005. And Aid for Trade is about helping countries address internal constraints to trade. So it can include helping with cumbersome regulations, or regulations that you find difficult to deal with into other countries. The lack of skills, poor infrastructure, whatever it is that's holding back the trade opportunities, we want to assist, and of course we want to deal with the priorities, which in many cases you're best placed to identify. We've committed $15 million towards the WTO-related initiatives on Aid for Trade, and this includes yesterday's announcement of a further $3 million to Phase 2 of the Enhanced Integrated Framework. Whoever came up with that name needs a medal. But to help the LDCs address their constraints to trade. And we continue to support Pacific Island countries' participation in the multilateral trading system. To this end, we're pleased to support the attendance of Pacific Island delegates at MC10. And Australian funding also supports the operation, of course, of the Pacific Islands WTO representative office in Geneva. We do feel it's very important for the islands and for all of you to have a capacity to have your point of view, your perspective, featured at the multilateral trade discussions and a forum of this nature. And if you don't get to these places, you'll never be heard. That's the problem, and we see it as a priority to help you travel and participate as most effectively as you can. Today, I'm also pleased to announce an increase in our support to that Geneva office, the WTO Pacific Island Geneva representative, and we'll provide up to $1 million per annum every year to the Forum Secretariat to improve services to the Pacific WTO members. On top of that, in June 2014, the Australian Government announced a new development policy and framework. This goes back to the Aid for Trade. We are now committed to 20% of all of our aid budget, which we've now directed overwhelmingly into the region around us. We think that's where we've got most responsibility. So the aid in toto has largely moved into the region, but 20% of it, that's our target to dedicate, to direct, to Aid for Trade. And for instance, it's just last year it was only 12%. This year it's 16%. So we're well on the way to getting our 20% target, and once we hit the 20%, we'll continue at that level as our aid budget increases in total. At the moment, 21% of our Aid for Trade expenditure goes to the Pacific, 21%. And our Aid for Trade investments are helping the Pacific countries with customs and border processes, which in many cases are real barriers, with supporting women entrepreneurs to export, assisting with investment attraction and retention, and encouraging local banks to provide affordable trade finance. And our previous speaker from Tonga was talked about finance, and it's nothing happens without finance. That's the bottom line, and very important, I think, for us to be able to assist in that regard as intermediaries with the banks in many respects. Australia supports a variety of initiatives to help Pacific Island countries to get the most out of the PACER Plus negotiations. For example, we're funding an office of the Chief Trade Advisor. In our view, the free trade agreements, you know, we're here at a multilateral agreement, and clearly a multilateral outcome is the best. But we've been 20 years trying to get another outcome since the Uruguay round. And in the meantime, there are a lot of things happening in the trade front. I think there's nearly 300 free trade agreements have been negotiated. And there's another 100 at the moment under negotiation. Now, people, I don't see a conflict with this. While we sort out how to get an outcome with 162 countries, which is not easy, while we work through that as a group, we are using these free trade agreements to help us in each of our own situations focus on what we do best, and similarly for other countries to focus on what they do best. And the PACER Plus, in our view, is it is going to assist with new trade opportunities across the board between one another, but also importantly with other countries. And I do feel that one of the most important things which has emerged in recent years, these global value and supply chains. You know, it's a world now where overwhelmingly lots of the things that we produce, certainly the things we produce in Australia, they end up as intermediate goods, as inputs into other products. Sometimes they move through five or six borders even before they end up as a final product. And it's not just the goods, it's also the services that we look to sell. And it's no different for you. And the opportunities now to focus on, to specialise in items that are not a final product in themselves, but can be something that you have developed an expertise in, or you've got a comparative advantage in because of the nature of your island, and perhaps the water around you has given you expertise, which it no doubt has in lots of areas, which can be tailored to in specialist products which now can enter the global supply chain. And these deals create that opportunity. I'm seeing it all around the world. These free trade agreements are, one, creating relationships. That's a very important thing, just the relationship itself, the understanding, the mutual trust. You were saying about the finance, you know, it falls through. So you've got to know, you need the trust. You need to develop the linkages and the trust. It's one of the big advantages, I think, and I did have play a big part in opening up the opportunity for people to come into Australia from the Pacific Islands and at a much greater level in the future, because I think that they come and work for 6 months and then they go back, and it develops the linkages that we develop in many cases endure for lifetime, and they can in turn create opportunities just between our country and the Pacific Islands. The same thing happens with New Zealand, of course, and I acknowledge my colleague Rodney, Minister McClay here, who's has been 3 days in the job. A very experienced politician, but he's looking to catch up with everyone in the room, perhaps around a drink a little bit later. But good to see you, Rod. I haven't got much more I really want to go through, except to say that we are committed to concluding that PACER Plus agreement by June next year, 2016. We've had sufficient time, I think, to workshop it. I think we're very close, and we will make every effort to in fact help that come to a conclusion over the next 6 months. Australia supports the Forum Secretariat's Pacific Islands Trade and Invest Network, which again I think I've got trade and investment, and the investment side I've found has been very important. A lot of the trade work is government to government, but the investment work is government to business, and it's made a real difference to have a role where you have to develop those investment relationships at the same time as developing the trading sort of framework that we're all trying to work with. The network supports Pacific exports and investment and tourism and creative arts promotion through direct finance and policy advice. And to me, this is critical. The network offices in Auckland, Beijing, Geneva, Sydney and Tokyo facilitated over 3.5 million in export sales and 11 million in investment and 30,000 on creative arts in 2014. And I just say to you, I looked at a totally different situation, but the principle is the same. Prime Minister Modi from India, when he took over, they had a real problem with investment into their countries. And he spent a lot of time in an aeroplane in the first 9 months of his prime ministership, and he visited major leaders all around the world, and as a consequence, and he was selling India as an investment destination. As a consequence, last year the biggest source of investment monies of any country in the world went to India, and a lot of it was just doing the hard yards, getting out there and selling what you've got to offer. And that's why I think while you are putting effort, as you must, into the framework and what will sustain the rules and all the rest of it in the years ahead of trade, the investment side of it, getting people to come in and join forces with you in different capacities, whether it's your energy programs or... There's a whole host of areas that I think are very attractive, but a lot of times you've got to get that in front of people. And we have very happily contributed. I think we facilitated over 3.5 million in export sales last year, 11 million in investment, and as I said, 30,000 in creative arts. And we've recently announced an increase in our contribution to the Network Sydney office to 2.5 million per annum. We're also supporting the Pacific Horticultural and Agricultural Market Access Program. The program helps Pacific Island countries meet the quarantine and other requirements of key trading partners through policy advice and support. Again, this is an area of great frustration. The sanitary and phytosanitary, some countries use it, I think, as a protection barrier, but others... the more that we can share knowledge about access on these fronts into third country markets, the easier and the quicker you'll be able to capitalise on some of the wonderful foodstuffs in particular that you produce, but also in other aspects of the trade. We have, of course, provided LDC's full duty-free and quota-free access to our markets for over 10 years, and it has contributed to notable increases in LDC exports, and averaging about 16% between 2004 and 2014. So that's another important component of our program, and it's our intention to bind those commitments at zero, to bind those zero tariffs and quota-free access in the PACER Plus agreement in 6 months' time. Ladies and gentlemen, I've just touched on various ways that Australia at least is actively trying to assist Pacific Island countries address, in many cases, the sort of unique challenges that you've got in tapping into global markets. I do think that... The circumstances and the technology that's emerging on all sorts of fronts has meant that you do face a more promising future than has been the case for a long time. There's just such a huge opportunity. The other thing is, for the first time in all our lifetimes, And certainly in Australia's case, for the first time since European settlement, the major drivers of world growth are all in our backyard. They're all these countries around us. And the opportunities are just unbelievable. And most Australians, I don't think, are seized with really what is happening in many of the countries around us. And I think the Pacific Islands, just like Australia, the next 10 and 20, 30 years can be, I think will be, but must be, really the best that any of us have witnessed because of those opportunities. But we've got to seize those opportunities. We want to help you seize those opportunities because I think you can set your islands up for decades, if not the rest of this century and beyond, with how we capitalise on the opportunities that are starting to emerge, not just in China. Of course, that's the face of it. You go to Vietnam now, it's jumping out of its skin. It's, you know, the opportunities there. So Malaysia, Indonesia. Indonesia has gone from one-tenth of the Australian size of an economy at the turn of the century to now nearly equal. In 15 years, they've gone from one-tenth the size of our economy to nearly equal our economy. It's unbelievable what's happening. So we'd like to be partners with you in helping to open up those opportunities. As close neighbours, it's very important that we do. We've got a vested interest. If you do well, we do well. And we really want you to do well. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Honourable Minister Robb, for the keynote address to this session. I believe that you have set the scene very well, recognizing the challenges of the Pacific. In fact, no one knows us better. No one knows the Pacific better rather than Australia and New Zealand. So thank you for that. And also for highlighting the opportunities that the Pacific can take advantage of from the information technology, the area of e-commerce, particularly for small business, the global value chains that are emerging, as well as the need to balance the rulemaking with the promotion of trade, as the Minister has outlined today, also recognizing the new energy roadmap by the government of Tonga, which will also be addressing one of the key challenges of the Pacific, which is energy, sustainable energy. Honourable Ministers, Excellencies and Pacific friends, I will now invite Honourable Fayaz Koya, the Minister for Trade and Industry of Fiji, to make his presentation on how to integrate small and medium enterprises into international trade and global value chains.
Thank you, Mary. Honourable Ministers, Excellencies, distinguished delegates, Bula Vanaka, and a very good afternoon to all of you. It's my pleasure and honour to be given this opportunity to speak on a topic that is of great significance to the Fijian government. And I hope to present some examples of how the Fijian government is positioning its small and medium enterprises to integrate into international trade and also in the national, regional, as well as global value chains. The Fijian Prime Minister, Honourable Bainimarama, is the champion of the micro and small medium enterprise development. It is a fact and tested belief of the Fijian government that the micro, small and medium enterprises are powerful forces for lifting people out of poverty and are a means of making a country strong, resilient and robust. The MSMEs, as we call them, are vital for employment creation, income generation, and poverty alleviation. Also in rural areas, developed areas, and innovation is driven through MSMEs with new ideas and new products, new methods of delivering services, and accessing markets coming out of MSMEs. An economy survey undertaken by the Fijian Bureau of Stats revealed that approximately 79% of the total registered businesses are micro, small, and medium enterprises. However, in terms of the numbers, the micro, small, and medium enterprises represent approximately 12% of the Fijian GDP, contributing about $800 million. The Fijian government is working towards increasing this contribution and bringing more micro-enterprises into the formal sector. And ladies and gentlemen, in order to undertake a holistic approach to micro and small and medium enterprise development, the Fijian government continues to put in place strategies to formalize the informal sector and through initiatives as simple as having all businesses register for a tax identification number. The government has also prioritized and strategies to assist MSMEs in accessing finance, which is often the biggest bottleneck to innovation. We recognize in this regard the need for appropriate regulatory and legal framework which requires immediate government action. And in terms of the institutional mechanism, the National Center for Small and Micro Enterprise Development, which we call NEXMED, is an institution created by the Small and Micro Enterprise Development Act. NEXMED has developed and orchestrated an array of business support resources and services to accelerate the successful development of the MSME sector. Ladies and gentlemen, and I wish to share some key policies and strategies and initiatives of the Fijian government that are focused on firstly providing the micro, small and medium enterprises to excel in the field of business, and secondly the ability for these businesses to integrate into international trade and also in the national, regional as well as global value chains. In around 2014, the government announced the Micro and Small Business Grant Scheme to come into place in 2015. The scheme allowed us to provide assistance targeted at the grassroots and to nurture individuals with special skill sets, whether they were craftspeople, carpenters or small-scale farmers. Any manner of skills that an economy like Fiji needs to thrive on. The scheme is especially unique as we have partnered with a commercial bank to assess applications and provide grants, and this is done through our Fiji Development Bank, which will ensure thorough assessment of all the projects and also enable the bank to provide additional assistance to ventures that have the potential to grow even further. Now, during the first year of implementation, at least 4,220 odd entrepreneurs have been assisted under the actual small business grant scheme. And through this scheme, we have improved the ability of these Fijian entrepreneurs to make a better livelihood for themselves and their families and the actual community. And it is our conviction that as these businesses grow, more jobs and wealth within their communities will be created. And ladies and gentlemen, in about 2013, the Fijian government also introduced the Small and Medium Enterprises Credit Guarantee Scheme with the aim of encouraging and supporting local businesses, particularly by promoting private sector lending to grow their businesses. And under the scheme, the government provides a guarantee of up to 50% of the outstanding principal amount of any default and SME business loans, and up to a limit of $50,000 per business. The government had set aside $3 million for that particular scheme, which is administered by the Reserve Bank of Fiji. And the scheme has actually grown to cover over 1,000 loans, valued at approximately $62 million, and to date only two claims totaling under $40,000 have been paid out, and thus representing about a 99.8% success rate of the actual scheme. And other budgetary initiatives include the exemption of income tax for micro, small and medium enterprises that earn a gross income of up to $500,000. These schemes and initiatives are enabling micro and small medium enterprises to become self-sustainable and become commercial entities focused on profits and to realize and maximize their competitive edge. Ladies and gentlemen, the Fijian government also will continue to work towards providing the relevant supporting mechanisms that provides long-term responses to strengthen linkages between the micro, small and medium enterprises, supplying raw and intermediate materials and large manufacturing time in order to ensure sustained domestic value chains, and also the ability to export and be part of the regional and global value chain. Whilst at the national level, countries can develop consistent and stable policies and strategies that will enable micro and small and medium enterprises to excel, it is also important that similar sentiments are reflected in global multilateral settings. Strategies at the international level should be supportive of what national governments are doing to promote the growth of small industries, and therefore specific issues that affect the integration of micro, small and medium enterprises into the global economy should urgently be addressed in a more focused and development-oriented manner. Fellow ministers and ladies and gentlemen, I wish to thank you also for giving me this opportunity to present the Fijian experience on how our government assists the micro and small and medium enterprises in an area of globalization and empower to become the vehicle of growth and development. I apologize for the short speech, but I know there's something on very quickly, so we've got two other speakers. Thank you. Vinaka Vakram.
Thank you, Honorable Fayaz Koer, for that statement. I will now invite Ambassador Joshua Kalinoy to share the Papua New Guinea government's experience on fishery subsidies. Ambassador.
Thank you, Chair. Excellency ministers, colleague ambassadors, colleagues, friends, it's a privilege to be part of this general discussion. We do have strong policies and programs for facilitating the growth of small and medium enterprises. But we would like to share on this occasion our limited experience, but growing experience, in the area of fisheries management and the IUU regulation, which also helps promote village-based, small-scale industries and experience. So I'd like to start by saying that more than 50% of our people in the coastal regions rely on the fisheries sector, and this creates, the sector itself creates small-scale businesses, especially at village level. And our experience in commercializing this industry has led us to develop useful experience in compliance issues. The IUU regulation, in our experience, is quite productive, quite accommodative, and it's making us become more aware of some of the issues that we were not aware of. Some of you might know the yellow flag that was issued to us with our major trading partner in the industry, which is the European Union. And through that, it was a wake-up call for us. And we were told, look, come to the negotiating table. Some of the things you're doing are not right. If you want to access our market, you need to be aware of some of these internationally accepted standards. So we took that on board with open arms, and it was quite humiliating for us in the beginning, but we humbled ourselves and we worked with the Europeans, and now we have developed a very good knowledge of the issues in tuna management, I mean stock management, on the issues of governance, transparency, on the issues of qualities for export to international markets. So for us, the experience is that to trade in fishery-related products, we have to get the basics right. We have to get the expectation of the trading partner on the other side and the world community right in order to trade the right product on right terms and conditions. So compliance, quality issues, stock management, and some regulatory aspects, which may in the beginning regard as areas that compromise our national sovereignty, we found that that's not the case. In fact, it helps us to strengthen our governance requirements, and it does not question in any way our national sovereignty to live and derive the benefits from this product. So in a nutshell, Chair and Honorable Ministers and colleagues, in our experience, we're happy to share with some of our friends in the Pacific to give you the comfort that IUU regulation is not something that we should be scared of. It's something that we should embrace and work through with those who have the experience in this area. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ambassador Kalinoy. I will now invite the Honourable Minister Mene Soalo, the Associate Minister for Commerce, Industry and Labour of Samoa, to deliver his statement on the role of aid for trade. Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Honourable Ministers, ladies and gentlemen, as the highest decision-making body of the WTO meets in Nairobi this week, I am very pleased that we have the opportunity through this forum this evening to focus on the Pacific's trade-related issues of importance, particularly the challenges and opportunities in promoting substantial development of Pacific Island countries through trade. I thank you, the International Center for Trade and Sustainable Development and the Government of Australia for making this possible. Having graduated from LDC status in January 2014, Samoa is a country in transition. But our inherent challenges to engage in international trade remain. And so is the role of aid for trade to support Samoa's integration into the global economy. While at this grassroots, the management of resources should therefore be focused on sustainable trade opportunities. This is in line with the theme of the EIF Phase 2, Securing Sustained Impact. As we heard yesterday at the pledging conference, donors are supportive of building on the successes and positive results from the Phase 1. This is an important aspect of sustainability, especially for Samoa as a current beneficiary. Aid for trade, to a large extent, has supported the transformation of Samoa's trade policy and institutional framework. In fact, Samoa's WTO accession process initiated the consolidation of Samoa's trade-related policies and strengthened its national framework. As a beneficiary of the EIF, Samoa has produced tangible results. The Diagnostic Trade Integration Study Action Matrix has been incorporated in the implementing framework of the Trade, Commerce and Manufacturing Sector Plan 2012-2016, where a number of activities have been implemented and many more to be completed. Today, the EIF is essentially the cornerstone of the implementation of Samoa's Trade, Commerce and Manufacturing Sector Plan. The review of this sector plan and the DTIS coincide with the development of Samoa's national strategic objectives for 2016-2020. Samoa's trade policy and institutional framework will be further strengthened. Support towards improving productivity and sustainable market access needs to continue. The Trade Sector Support Program aims to improve production systems, productivity, and consistency in quantity and quality for export, marketing information, and appropriate technology for value addition. At the regional level, the Pacific Aid for Trade Strategy 2014-2017 aims to expand trade in the region as part of the Pacific Plan for Regional Integration. The Pacific Aid for Trade programs continue to support Samoa's participation in regional trade negotiations. Honourable Ministers, ladies and gentlemen, trade creates jobs and therefore support the livelihoods of our people. Sustainable trade will ensure the long-term benefits for our communities and our vulnerable economies. Aid for Trade plays an essential role in ensuring that our resources and capacity constraint countries fully benefit from the international trade. But aid for trade alone is not sustainable without national commitment and ownership. More importantly, aid for trade is a valuable complement to the development agenda at the multilateral level. It is therefore important that the outcome of this ministerial conference in Nairobi maintains the development elements and flexibilities for our small economies. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Honourable Minister. May I now turn to our last panelist this afternoon, the His Excellency Moses Morsi, the Ambassador of Solomon Islands to the European Union and Permanent Representative to the WTO, who is standing in for the Minister of Commerce of the Solomon Islands, speaking on the role of aid for trade.
Thank you, Honorable Ministers, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. I stand in for my minister, who is unable to be here this afternoon and, of course, attend the WTO ministerial conference because of a budget session back in the Solomon Islands. But I will briefly share some of our experiences in terms of the use of the funding that is given to us through the EIF. I think we are one of the first beneficiaries of the EIF funding program. We've now on tier two funding, and of course, previously we also received funding under tier one. And I have here with us the coordinator of the EIF program in the Solomon Islands. And I know that we do not have time, otherwise I'll give him the microphone to share some of those experiences. But in terms of the funding itself, we have benefited enormously, and it has helped train our people to be able to have the capacity and, of course, to establish the necessary institutional capacity to deal with supporting trade, supporting the private sector, especially in the tourism sector now that we are proceeding on tier one or tier two funding. It has also helped us to establish the National Trade Development Council, which provides an oversight and coordination on trade, trade development, and of course support to the private sector. The funding also helps us to provide training for participants in the private sector in terms of how to build their capacity and, of course, to do business and trade. Under the Tier 2 funding that we've just received last year in January, the focus is on the tourism development, and it has helped our small operators in the ecotourism sector to develop their projects, as well as to provide small grants to the small operators to develop their tourism projects. It has also helped the government to put together national policies and regulations and to develop standards to be able to provide the kind of services to the tourism sector that is acceptable to our visitors. So indeed, it is very beneficial indeed, and we want to thank Australia, New Zealand, and other development partners, the European Union, for providing this kind of support to us, especially the LDCs and small island developing states in the Pacific, to facilitate our trade development and also to help our private sector. But speaking on sustainable development, I think it's also very important for us to have the right policies, and of course the right regulatory and legislative reforms to support the private sector. And also, it is also important for us to have the political will to drive this process. Without that political will, we cannot be able to provide that kind of support to our private sector development. And interestingly, we've heard from the Minister of Fiji how Fiji is doing it, and I think we should learn from what Fiji is doing in supporting their small and medium enterprises in Fiji to develop and be able to be part of the process of creating employment and income. Of course, many of us in the Pacific, the issue of stability is also another very crucial issue that we need to address. Stability is very important in terms of governance. And in the absence of that, continuity in implementing, good policies are not possible. So I think it's very important in order for us to be able to attract the right kind of investors who are willing to invest their money in our countries to sustain and to contribute to development and, of course, the development of SMEs. But more importantly for us too in the islands is the issue of infrastructure. That is also lacking in many respects. The development of infrastructure is crucial in terms of creating the environment for the private sector to develop. Infrastructure here, I'm talking about, you know, like now IT is very important. We need to have the right telecommunication technologies, the internet to do business. And of course, we need to have the funding, the affordable funding for the SMEs to be able to access funding to develop and to invest in their business. And I think this is an area that is still lacking in some of our countries, and I speak for my own country. So I think sustainable development needs a variety of issues that need to be addressed at the national level and, of course, at the regional level, and, of course, with the support of our development partners like Australia, New Zealand, and the European Union and others, I'm sure we can continue to develop and to assist our SMEs to develop and to grow in the islands. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador Moses. We will now open the floor for questions. Sherry, how are we going for time? Is there any? I'll probably limit the questions. Yeah, if we can probably have two questions from the floor, and I'm sure as we proceed to the cocktail, we can then have the question and answers continued in the in the reception. So if there are any specific questions that that you would like to pose to the ministers, and also the Honourable Minister from Australia, we would welcome your questions. So two questions, please.
Yes, good evening. I'm Murabu Odari from Kenya. And my question is more in terms of the limitations to, in terms of the population and maybe the resources. Have we looked into sports? Being that I'm an ardent rugby fan, I have constantly interacted with most of the nations here at that level. So are the various governments looking at that? Because in Kenya you find diaspora remittances being the highest earners of foreign exchange for this country. So have the countries prioritized sports in exportation of sports in that level, specifically like rugby, to be a source of capturing? Thank you.
Thank you for that question, and I'm sure most of our ministers are willing to respond. So I'll probably give the floor first to Minister Koya, and then perhaps Minister Tuyonito would also like to respond to that.
I think we all might give one response, right, Samuel Tonga? In terms of rugby, we actually, there's a lot of income that comes out of rugby and remittances that we've exported our rugby players. I think if I speak for Samoa and Fiji and Tonga, yes, it's something that does bring back a lot of revenue for us. And you'll find also it's not just the players who actually made the national team. There's quite a few that are on the fringes that get picked up in Australia, New Zealand and France, but... it is a big thing for us, most definitely.
Sufficient answer?
Minister?
Thank you for the question from Kenya. When I was given the topic to talk about renewable energy, I was thinking if I might be given to talk about the rugby, because we do have a comparative advantage over Kenya. But we do give a very importance to raise the standard of sport in Tonga, especially rugby, any other sport. Right now, we have many players all over the world. And we see we got good respect to Australia. We have some Tongan there. in the Wallabies and also in All Blacks, so in the various in Japan, we have the good boy that will make the right decision at the end to beat the Springboks. That's another Tongan. So we take a very good emphasis on the sports. Of course, with limited funding, of course. But we do whatever we can do. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm Elizabeth Bachivinga Gaswaga, League Advisor, Rule of Law with the Commonwealth Secretariat. My question is addressed to all the panelists. Is there a need for regulatory and legal reforms in pursuit for trade and development in the Pacific region now? And if so, what would be the priorities and strategies towards achieving those reforms? Thank you.
Thank you for that question. Would any of the ministers like to respond to that? Priorities for regulatory reforms? I know many of our member states have already developed national trade policies. Some through the enhanced integrated framework, such as the Solomon Islands. Fiji has just adopted a new national trade policy framework, and perhaps the reform to some of the national legislation that will need to be done, whether it's in the area of customs or SPS or TBT, will also need to accompany some of those reforms. So does any of the ministers,
Just quickly, Chair. We've just developed our trade policy framework, and within the framework, we have a set up, and it's a living document, so it actually moves. But in terms of the regulatory framework, we're constantly looking at that, and because of, as I say, us having just published that, it is something that government's looking forward to doing, and it's an ongoing process for us. And obviously, being in tune with the rest of what we're actually doing at the moment too, so it is an important issue for us, so we do deal with it. And in terms of assistance, we never say no. I think the right people are listening.
Could I just add to that? From my perspective, I thought we had an excellent contribution from our PNG colleague here on the front table, about some of the priorities that the EIF is contributing to, and in many cases it's just the availability of people who've got that skills and experience. It's a very critical process, but that's where I think the PACER Plus is. It'll set one set of trading rules between Australia, New Zealand and the Pacific Islands, and the significance of one set of trading rules can't be underestimated. It is setting, it does mean more seamless trade, it means less paperwork, it just facilitates the ease of trade, and especially when you're dealing with, as we are, in a lot of small businesses. And so I feel that we are well advanced, but there's 6 months to go. There's still quite a bit of work to do, but I think it's one area that we can actually nail down quickly and to the great advantage of the region. Thanks.
Thank you, Minister. Mm-hmm. Thank you for that. So last question
Yes, a last point. My name is David Vivas from the ONTAC Secretariat. Thank you for the Minister for the excellent comment. One question inspired on the Ambassador of PNG comments on the issue of Sustainable Development Goals, Goal 14, the WTO agenda, and what could be done immediately in this ministerial. What's the view of the Minister, and what shall we be doing in relation to eliminating certain form of fish subsidies? that might create imbalances in how we harvest fish and also who gets the benefits from fisheries. What ministers think about it, what we should do in this ministerial conference.
Very good question. We've got some notes that we want to share with you, but because of time, I didn't go to that extent. But I think fisheries for us, and I'm sure with the rest of the Pacific countries, is an important issue. And as the Minister for, Honorable Minister for Fiji, sorry, the delegate for Fiji this morning mentioned in the SVE meeting, that the issue of subsidies is an issue that this conference must have a position on. And we in Papua New Guinea share the same view, that subsidy must be discussed and a position has to be taken, but not necessarily going into the details. But the position has to be taken, and this has to come under the ambit of the, in our view, in my delegation's view, under the ambit of the DDA round of discussions. DDA must not be killed. That's Papua New Guinea's position. Our plea to our developed partners in the WTO is to look at it positively and keep it alive. It cannot be killed in this round of discussions. And anything, including the agriculture, NAMA, and fisheries is part of that, subsidies should come under that. So when the, in our view, the time for new ideas is over. Time for amendments to DDA is over. This is time for action, time for negotiations. That's Papua New Guinea's position. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador. I know there are lots of questions and lots of interest. Can I just allow one more last question, Sherry, please? Oh.
Thank you very much to all the panel. It's been really, really interesting, and thank you for taking the time to come from your, out of your busy schedule. I guess I just want to ask a question in an area that's dear to my heart, but also very, very important for the PIF countries, and that is services. And I was just wondering if you might comment on what the new services opportunities you see that may come out of a concluded PACER Plus agreement that Dr. Edwini Kesley is shepherding along. This is so important for the economies of all of your countries. And services and investment are both very critical components of the future PACER Plus agreement. Do you see it opening up the possibility for more inter-regional services among yourselves in that context? And are you excited about those opportunities?
Thank you, Sherry. Would any of the ministers like to respond to that, or shall we defer this to our chief trade advisor?
We've got a specialist here.
We've got a specialist here in that area, and that happens to be my permanent secretary. Maybe I'll let him answer that for you. Shane?
There, thank you for that question, and thank you, Minister, for putting me on the spot. But yeah, as the Minister for Australia mentioned, there is some gains to be made with compliance in regulatory frameworks and compliance in rules and regulations in terms of creating a single sort of rules standards. However, in terms of getting gains out of services, trade, and investments, there needs to be fundamentals of the Pacific economies to be set straight. So in order to do that, the fundamentals need to be right, because the investments only follows if there's profitability, there's things like stability in the economy, then there's true gains to be made. So yes, There are gains to be made through PESA Plus in terms of getting the rules right, but I think the fundamentals in terms of sustainability and other fundamentals, the macroeconomic policies, need to be right to create that stability for investors to have that confidence to invest in our economies.
Thanks for that. Could I just add a comment? It's been referred to already, but and it's obviously a significant component of many of the incomes of the Pacific Islands, but the whole tourism area. Again, I mentioned the explosion in opportunity that's occurring around us. 100 million people left China last year for a holiday. We got 1 million came to Australia, but the government in Beijing say to me that by 2020, not 10 years or 20 years away, but in 5 years' time, they expect around 220 million people to leave China for a holiday, all around the world, obviously. But so from 100 million last year to 220 million in 5 years' time. Now, the other thing is that the profile is changing dramatically of the Chinese tourist. In Australia, just 4 years ago, 80%, 85% of the tourists were tour groups. Now we're finding that's dropped to 35%, and the other 65% are now, one, they're younger, two, independently wealthy, three, they want very five-star experiences, they want unique experiences. Now this is where a lot of your offerings come into play, because you all offer a unique experiences, and the investors, you did say, services are very much linked to investment, and there is, at the moment, there's a lot of money. The world's awash with cheap money, but it's also awash with very nervous investors. So if you can get a project sort of investment ready, there is a lot of interest, and it can be cheap money and people coming in and substantially funding it. And I just feel that this is an opportunity which we've got to seize upon. It's a clear priority. It's something we all know well, every country in the room. But there's an opportunity to perhaps take it to another level, higher value tourism, higher margins, bigger returns. And it's quite that is really exciting, and it's something we all know and do, and it's on our doorstep, and it's there to be capitalised on. Thanks.
I just wanted to share that so far, Sherry had helped us a lot in undertaking a regulatory review of the trade services and investment regimes, and that has actually that informed most of the countries which have submitted their offers. So I think it's been encouraging. So far, the offers that we have received from the Pacific Island countries, they have shown ambition, and they have actually, they want to attract investment in other tourism, apart from tourism, into other services sectors. So if that continues, I think there would be a boost to the services sector. On investment as well, the countries have shown ambition. They have very few reservations, and so far I think it's quite encouraging. So I think the PESA Plus would result in the countries attracting investment into the critical sectors of their economy. So I think there should be positive spin-offs from the PESA Plus negotiations.
Thank you, Dr. Casey. We are running really behind time, and I suggest that we move over into the next session, the reception, and we could probably ask some of the questions. But I have the honor to bring this session to a conclusion. I will not summarize what has been discussed this afternoon. I think you all have heard, but briefly to thank the Honourable Minister Rob for his keynote address to this meeting, in which he has also outlined some of the important aid for trade work that the government of Australia is doing globally in the WTO and also in the region in supporting our trade development in the Pacific. We know that we are here for the MC10 to try and secure some outcomes from the multilateral rules. But I think the panel this afternoon has given us a snapshot of the different initiatives that are being pursued by our different governments, our various governments, to try and strengthen our economies and prepare us to integrate successfully into the multilateral trading system. So we've heard the initiatives in the sectoral areas such as the energy plan of Tonga, the fisheries dealing with IUU fisheries in the case of Papua New Guinea, in the case of the government of Samoa. They working on manufacture. They have a manufacturing sector plan that has been developed under the EIF framework, and also Fiji sharing its experience on the SME development. So all these areas initiatives with a view to strengthening our economies to ensure that they will be able to benefit from the trade opportunities that are being negotiated in the region and also multilaterally. Of course, Ambassador Moses also shared the EIF experience and the benefit to the Solomon Islands tourism sector, and also stressed the other important issues that need to be addressed, such as infrastructure and stability. So without further ado, I would like to unfortunately bring this session to a close, because ministers have another appointment this evening. And I would like to finally extend our thanks on behalf of the Pacific Islands Forum to our partner, the ICTSD, in organizing this panel, to Sherry and Sophie and the team. Thank you for being patient with us. We know we've been out of Geneva, in and out of Geneva, so thank you for helping us put together this Pacific Side event. And also to the Government of Australia for supporting this event. And finally, to thank you all, Honourable Ministers, thank the panellists this afternoon for their contribution, and friends from the Pacific that share our interest. Thank you.